Welcome. My name is David Malone. I have the privilege of working at the UN University in Tokyo. And this evening in Tokyo, we'll have as our guest Professor Andrew Hurrell from Oxford University. He occupies one of the two oldest chairs in Britain in international relations. He's been at Oxford University for many years, but he plays many roles beyond the university, for example, in Oxford University Press. But having established also a global identity for the program he's associated with, wonderful master's and doctoral program at the university, but also as a contributor to activities of other institutions. So, Andy, we're tremendously privileged to have you with us today. And this evening we'll be talking about whether perhaps in the altered circumstances of today, March 2017, we may be facing the beginning of an end of what we've thought of as the rule of law in international relations. And that corresponds a bit to something that you've written about a lot and very cogently, global order. Global order, I assume, has always been contested in a sense, but the rhetoric of rule of law has been very strong since the Second World War. So I wanted to ask you, in the guise of a bit of an introduction as to what we'll be talking about this evening, if you could talk about the relationship between order and law.
I think the most important starting point to a conversation is to recognize that there are different kinds of relationships between order on the one hand and law and the rule of law on the other. One of the problems I think we face in this moment and at this time is that there is an obvious tendency, understandable tendency, to talk in very polarized terms between the continued existence of the global liberal order on the one hand and, if you like, almost anarchy and chaos on the other. Now, clearly, the rule of law was deeply connected to those ideas of the global liberal order, but in a very particular way. Indeed, one might perhaps suggest that there were excessively ambitious ideas about the global rule of law and what the global rule of law could do that were part of the project of the global liberal order. So in the sort of technical functional area, the idea that notions of international and global order could be replaced by ideas of global governance, managing, regulating whole areas of international life, as the word global governance implies, in a sort of more technical, perhaps depoliticized way. Equally, within the debates on international law, there was a great deal of attention, certainly in Western international law and certainly in European international legal circles, with the idea that the forward movement of the post-Cold War world could be pushed even further, that we could constitutionalize the global legal order, the United Nations would play an absolutely central role in the global political and security order, the World Trade Organization would be the heart of the
international courts.
The expansion of international courts, the expansion of the agenda of global justice, the International Criminal Court, and so on. That movement, that was what the rule of law consisted of. And so now, when we're in a period where the challenges to order are obviously much more serious, as I said, the notion is that if we can't have that, we can't have anything. Well, it seems to me that the most important starting point is to recognize that there are different roles, maybe more limited roles, as to what international organization and international law can achieve or can try to achieve, and that in thinking about the global rule of law, we also have to recover some of those alternative meanings rather than simply complain and worry about the fact that this particular vision attractive though it was in many ways, appears to be less attainable than it was before.
I think that particular vision, as you put it, which I shared in, and I think you did too, was much more attractive in the transatlantic space than in Asia. So in a sense, in Asia, what some of the new dispensation might look like might be a more hegemonic world with several hegemons vying for influence without necessarily much international superstructure to be displaced, so to speak, because most Asian countries never signed up for projects like the European Union. And if they did sign up to UN treaties, conventions that involved arbitration, some subservience, so to speak, to court systems, it was not the centerpiece of their project for themselves internationally. So in that sense, Asia's an outlier. Much of Asia, I think, is disturbed by the collapse of the TPP, for example. But the notion of this international rule of law being qualified, if that's what happens, is perhaps less upsetting in Asia than it might be to a Canadian like I am, or to somebody living at the heart of Europe.
I think that's right. I think there's an important degree of ambiguity, though, in how the broader world looks at the challenges to the rule of law. I think it's exactly right, as you suggest, to say that many parts of what I've called the kind of normative expansion and normative ambition of international order after the Cold War took insufficient account of the views of many different parts of the world. In the early post-Cold War period, when US and Western power seemed so overwhelming, there was a feeling in many parts of the world, particularly the emerging and developing world, that they sort of had to come to terms with it and they had to sign up to things that they didn't really agree with, but this was, in a sense, the only game in town. Now, as it becomes apparent that it isn't necessarily the only game in town, and that many of those institutions are facing challenges, it becomes easier again, in a sense, to maybe come out in your truer colors and to sort of say, well, we never really quite bought in to the more, say, interventionist end of responsibility to protect or the stronger end of court enforcement in terms of many other legal norms. So that's on the pushback side, if you like. On the other side, though, it is a feature of the moment in which we're living that the developing and emerging world, by and large, is the part of the world that is keenest on keeping some of the institutional structures of multilateral order. After all, these are the structures, this is the world in which, by and large, they have done relatively well. And so they look at the UN and at the trading system and are profoundly worried by the challenges to its continued existence. And equally at public opinion level, we look at attitudes to globalization, positive attitudes to globalization and global integration are strongest across the emerging world. The challenges, the most serious challenges to many institutions and to the idea of the global rule of law seem to be coming from the heart of the Western system rather than from the other side. So there is a kind of ambiguous position. There was a pushback against what many people saw as the overreach of what a Western dominated system sought to achieve. Certainly a pushback towards a system that wants harder notions of sovereignty, wants more pluralism, wants more respect for difference, for civilizational difference, for different values. But on the other hand, a concern that if multilateralism really enters into hard waters, they will be losers as well from that loss.
Indeed. And it seems to me the developing world always gets lumped in together. But in fact, preferences vary a lot across the continents. For example, voting patterns at the UN suggest that Latin American governments, by and large, really do care about human rights. Mm-hmm. And that's what's allowed in the Human Rights Council, where everything is contested. Yep. By and large, more progress in the last 10 years mm-hmm. than might have been expected. So Latin American preferences turn out to matter quite a lot mm-hmm. on that. Whereas Asian governments are more relaxed. They don't want to be human rights oppressors mm-hmm. themselves, but they don't want to be dictating to their neighbors either, with Africa perhaps having preferences of its own. So I think this notion of sort of accelerated progress towards supranational law mm-hmm. Is something that in the transatlantic world was controversial, but seemed fairly irreversible until recently. Mm-hmm. But to the rest of the globe, was perhaps not viewed in quite the same way.
No, I think that's right. And of course, even within regions, attitudes vary. So if you take Latin America, for example, Argentina, which had in previous periods been, in a sense, an example of quite strong traditional third worldist skepticism about many aspects of human rights, many aspects of multilateralism in the post-Cold War period became a strong supporter. Brazil, on the other hand, very keen on the importance of the idea of human rights, although often keen on the importance of a broader understanding about what human rights consist of, but very much worried about selectivity and about bias in the way in which Western transatlantic European governments and American administrations sought to enforce human rights. So even there was a big difference between a view that human rights really matter and a skepticism about how multilateral institutions might be used and abused in the pursuit of human rights. And actually that example, the example of Brazil compared to other places in Argentina, also brings out, I think, an important more general feature. We often think of kind of culture, civilizations, people having different views about international order. But sometimes sort of quite simple factors are very important. Big countries tend almost uniformly to be very concerned about their sovereignty,
yes.
to be very suspicious of attempts to dictate. And so the big country phenomena and the increased importance, maybe a return to big country power politics, is also a feature that feeds into attitudes to the rule of law. The United States in this respect is actually very similar to other big countries in its historic, yes we like Western values, yes of course we want to promote them, but we ourselves do not want to be too tied down by other people trying to enforce them
Indeed.
Against
and us. Then again, huge difference, because looking back to the World Trade Organization about 10 years ago, Brazil and India were the two emerging countries playing a big role, it seems to me. China was still in the background then. And actually, their approach was rather different. Brazil, which is a great trading nation, which needs to trade, actually wanted a breakthrough agreement, whereas India, which has not been traditionally since independence such a great trading nation, on balance preferred not to be constrained. And that's what led ultimately to the breakdown of the project of a more ambitious World Trade Organization. So the idea that it's always the Western powers that called every shot was probably wrong anyway.
That's right. And I think on trade and the WTO, you can clearly see the differences in their particular interests. But you can also, I think as you suggest, see in that different both negotiating styles and different conceptions of how and where as an emerging power you fit in. So within, in a sense, the Brazilian tradition, a part of the focus has long been on trying to be the country that helps brokers deals in different yes. multilateral fora. Yes, of course you might want to bargain hard, but you still want the deal mm-hmm. to happen. On the other hand, India has long, in a sense, been known diplomatically as the country that likes to say no. Mm. And in defense of that position, it's a position which has yielded, one can say, a significant number of benefits and successes.
And also in bilateral diplomacy, India is a country that quite often says yes. Yeah. It's just it doesn't like to be bullied or seen to be bullied multilaterally. Yeah. So different conceptions. Now coming back to the notion of if not yet global disorder, a beginning of a breakdown of the order we know, and perhaps different approaches to law, this doesn't necessarily imply World War III. But very rapidly, discourse tends to default to all or nothing.
Yeah, exactly.
Either supranationalism or Third World War. And that strikes me as not terribly helpful in the current circumstance, or indeed ever.
No, exactly. And I think that's exactly what I would like to try to suggest. And I think that we, both as academics and also in the policy and the political world, need to focus our attention on. So just to give one example of what that might mean, for good reason, obviously for very good reasons, a lot of the focus on debates about intervention has been focused on ideas of humanitarian intervention, has been focused on ideas of the responsibility to protect. That has almost completely dominated the discussion of what intervention means in global politics. And even people writing histories of intervention in the past period have really told stories of how we got to humanitarian intervention. Well, obviously important, and I don't think those calls, certainly not the crises, but also the debates about response to humanitarian catastrophes is going to go away, unfortunately. But it's very important to realize that the idea of intervention is something which raises broader and different sets of questions. Intervention appeared as a concept to capture a space, if you like, between war on the one hand and normal day-to-day diplomacy on the other. It was something that international law and major powers recognized as a space that needed to be regulated, sometimes legally, but often politically. So major powers needed to come to a set of understandings about what kinds of intervention would be politically problematic, what kinds of places where different forms of intervention might be more or less acceptable to the major powers, areas and subjects where it might become much trickier. Now, that's the sort of debate on intervention which existed in the classical European system. It very much existed during the years of the Cold War. When things were going better, one of the reasons they were going better is that the superpowers managed to agree on some sets of understandings about the forms of intervention that they found more or less mutually acceptable and those that they didn't. Now, it seems to me when we look at some of the crises in the contemporary world, be it in Ukraine or in Syria very obviously, trying to recover and help the major powers recover and rebuild a set of understandings about the norms of intervention seems to me a very major task that those concerned with international order will need to help to do. So to broaden the intervention, not to say that humanitarian types of intervention are unimportant, absolutely not, but to recognize that that sort of focus does not exhaust the things that we need to talk
indeed.
About.
Indeed. And to conclude our brief chat now, your last comments are a very good segue into what the new Secretary General of the UN, if I understand him correctly, is trying to do, which is suggest that the UN isn't inherently a fantastic operator of military deployments around the world, although it does that competently in a number of places, that above all it's a political actor and a political instrument for conflict prevention, hopefully, but also the type of negotiating that can lead to rapid resolution or standoff in situations where conflict occurs, rather than these decades-long deployments, which are hugely expensive and often rather inconclusive, as we know. So I wanted to ask you how you see, whether you think the UN is capable of adjusting to this amount of change, and how you think it might adjust to a different approach to order and law.
Well, I think that you highlight very well the nature of the challenge. In part, of course, the UN has been a particular example of an institution that has long suffered from excessive ambition, excessive expectation. As people often say, the United Nations need to be protected from its friends as well as its enemies. Going right back to the early days, if one believed that the United Nations was going to constitute a revolution or transformation in the character of international relations, then of course one was bound to be disappointed, and successively, of course, disappointment then leads to the idea that it's all a waste of time and it should all be scrapped. So in a sense, calibrating expectations to realities whilst maintaining the notion that progress is possible is a central part of the task of anyone, I think, working in the United Nations, especially as Secretary General. And of course, calibrating that task in a period where contestation amongst the major powers is already and likely to remain higher than it has been is also going to push the United Nations, I think, to think very hard about those areas where it will perhaps be able to contribute in this more directly political, diplomatic way to assisting others in resolving, or if not resolving, at least managing disputes. So I think that's the one thing. The second thing I think is really fundamentally important. I mean, one of the great problems in the period we are in at the moment is that we've lost the capacity to really debate openly and productively about the forms of global order that we want to promote. In almost every country, there is a lot of introversion, there's a lot of introspection, everyone is preoccupied with their own problems. Compared to the 1940s, when almost everybody, right across the political spectrum, believed that a discussion about global order was a necessary part of international, of national political life as well as international political life. So it seems to me that one of the crucial functions of the United Nations is to help recover that capacity to debate and deliberate what international order ought to look like. The actual role of the United Nations within it as a political actor will almost certainly always remain relatively constrained, but its capacity to promote informed debate, political debate, seems to me to be, I would actually say, the most important function that we might hope to see coming out of the organization in the
Indeed.
Years to come.
And that needn't undermine humanitarian action on the ground at all, or a number of the other things that a number of UN agencies are demonstrably quite good at, given the funds necessary to do them. Well, Andy, I hope you'll come back in a few years and we'll see where we are. Thank you very much for joining us today for this public debate a bit later on, and for joining viewers online to give them a taste of what we try to bring to our public here in Tokyo of an evening, which isn't really certainty about anything much, but rather the iterative process of puzzling our way through international complexity, which is what you do every day with your students, with the books that you write and oversee, and for us here is a privilege. So thank you all online for joining us, And I hope one day you may be in Tokyo and able to join us live in this hall of the UN University building on Aoyama Dori. Thank you very much.